Welcome everyone to the Inside Java Newscast, episode 10, where we cover recent developments in the OpenJDK community. My name is Jose. I know you must be very disappointed not to see Nikolai, but don't worry, he will be back soon. So, sorry about that, but today, no.
That's it. That's all I can say at the moment.
But still, three topics for you. The first release candidate of Java 17 is here, which is great news. Second, why you should not be using the finalized method from the object class anymore. And third topic, be careful with value-based classes. And a fourth bonus topic, if you want to contribute to the OpenJDK, some hints about how to do it. So, with no further ado, let's get started. First and foremost, the first release candidate of the JDK 17 is here. Remember that the final release of the JDK 17 is due next September the 14th. You can grab it on this URL or click on the link down below. We already covered the list of features on the previous newscast, so I'm not going to go through them all. I just would like to shed some light on three of my favorites. The first one are the sealed classes as a permanent feature that we covered in Jeb Cafe episode 2. The second one is pattern matching for switch, a preview feature covered in newscast episode 8. And third, two incubator features, the foreign function and memory API and the vector API. If you want to give a try at the preview features or incubator features, but don't know how to activate them, then you can read this article by my friend David Delabasse, published on Java Magazine. Link down below. By the way, if you don't know Java Magazine, then you should really check it and subscribe. Second topic, I would like to focus on the finalize method from the object class that has been deprecated in Java SE9. You know that finalize is one of the methods from the object class that every object in Java has and that you can override. So, what is the contract of finalize? Well, the Java doc tells you that it's called by the garbage collector on an object when garbage collection determines that there are no more references to this object. It also tells you that the Java programming language does not guarantee which thread will invoke the finalize method for any given object. And this point makes the overriding of finalize a very good source of concurrent programming bug. Let me just show you one of them. Suppose you have an object that holds an array list in a field, and you want to help the garbage collector by clearing this array list in the finalize method. What you're going to do is called clear on that list. And this is going to execute the following code. First step, you increment mod count, which is an internal counter in the ArrayList class used to detect concurrent modifications. Now, it turns out that this field is not thread safe, so here you have a race condition. Your application thread updated mod count under the hood, and now your garbage collector thread is updating it too. The problem is that anything can happen here. You may be incrementing an out-of-date value, or your modification may not be seen in other threads. That's what a race condition is. Second step, you copy element data to a local variable of the clear method. Element data is the reference to the internal array of this ArrayList object. This reference is mutable, so that's the second race condition, because it is not thread-safe neither. You may be copying an out-of-date reference and then operate on it. And the third step is this for loop. You iterate over this array to put null values in it. Well, this size field is also mutable, also not thread safe, so that makes a third race condition. If you're really unlucky, you may end up with an array out-of-bounds exception on this line. Fortunately, it will not crash your application because the garbage collector can handle this exception. But it will crash your finalize method. No more code will be executed in it past this line. So be careful with this finalize method. Trying to help the garbage collector was not a great idea anyway. And putting any critical code in a finalized method is not a good idea anyway. The Java doc also tells you that the finalized method might perform explicit I/O transactions to break the connection before the object is permanently discarded. If this is the case, you have another more reliable way to do that. You can implement the auto-closable interface and move the closing of your connection in the close method of this interface. The auto-closable interface is very simple to implement. You have only one method to implement, which is the close method. And starting with Java SE 7, all the auto-closable objects can be used in a try with resources statement, including your own objects. Many objects of the JDK are auto-closable. All the objects of Java I/O, for instance, from JDBC, the Java Database Connection API, and even the stream interface itself extends auto-closable. The third topic is another warning about the use of value-based classes. Value-based classes have been defined in Java SE 11, and there are 7 points that define a value-based class. The first one is that a value-based class only defines final instance fields. And the second point is linked to the first one. The class itself is final, and it only extends object or a hierarchy of abstract classes that declare no instance field. So what does it mean? In a nutshell, it means that the state of a value-based class is first immutable, and second, only carried by the class itself, just like records. Third point, the class does not declare accessible constructors, or these constructors have been deprecated for removal. Now, this point removes records from value-based class, because records have a public constructor, so that's the end of the comparison with records. And the fourth point goes one step further. The class does not provide any instance creation mechanism that promises a unique identity on each method call. What does it mean? You do not have any accessible constructor and no factory method whose contract would be to call the private constructor for you. Let me explain what these last 2 points mean exactly. Suppose you're calling string s equal new string and pass hello as a parameter. You are explicitly asking the runtime for a new instance of the string class, and you will get it. But if you call string s equals hello between double quotes, the JVM may give you an instance of string that was created earlier in your application. It may not be a new, freshly created instance of the string class. And because string is immutable, it's totally fine. Your code will work fine with this shared instance. With value-based classes, you cannot explicitly ask for a new instance. So what you can do with string, you cannot do it with a value-based class, neither through a constructor nor through a factory method. This is what these last 2 points really mean. So when you ask for an instance of a value-based class, you cannot tell in advance if what you will be getting is a new instance or an existing instance. And your code should not rely on the fact that every instance you get is different than the others, all the same as the others. Let us take a look, for instance, at the integer class. You have a constructor that creates an integer from an int value, primitive type. By the way, this constructor has been deprecated for removal, so you shouldn't be using it anymore. And calling this constructor will give you a new instance every time you call it. Why? Because you are calling a constructor, and this is what constructors are doing. But if you use the factory method valueOf that takes the same int as a parameter, which is now, by the way, the preferred pattern, the behavior is different. If the int you pass is between minus 128 and plus 127, then you get a cached value. This is written in the Java doc. So if you call value of 10 twice, it will return the same integer instance. Now, if you call value of 314 twice, it may return the same instance or it may not. You cannot tell in advance. So if two instances of the integer class are equal in the sense of the equal method from the object class, then they may be the same object in memory, or they may be different instances. What the value-based class definition tells you is that the code you are writing should not rely on this, neither on the fact that the instances are the same, nor that they are different. For instance, using integer.valueOf1 as a monitor holder for synchronization is a violation of this specification, because it will only work if this value of call always returns the same instance. So if you are doing that in your code, you are violating the value-based class specification. You may have bugs in a future version. What are the classes from the JDK that are value-based as of now? Well, basically all the wrapper types classes, integer, long, and the like, but also classes from the date and time API as local date, and optional also fits the definition of value-based classes. But that's not all. You can also define your own value-based classes in your application very easily. What are the benefits of using value-based class? Well, as of now, maybe not that many. But in the future, because this specification is part of the Valhalla project, at some point, what you can expect is better performances to process value-based classes instances. More info on that on the Valhalla project page. See the link down below. And the bonus news is about contributing to the OpenJDK. You may have noticed that the OpenJDK begins with the word open, and open in that case means that everybody is welcome to contribute. And yes, it means also you. Mark Reinhold, chief architect of the Java Platform Group at Oracle, just mentioned a talk he gave several years ago on this exact topic. It's a 20-minute talk, so it will not take you very long to watch it, and it is extremely interesting as it gives you valuable hints on what you can do and how you can do it. Let me also mention the episode 11 of the Inside Java podcast called How to Contribute to the OpenJDK with Stuart Marks and Jesper Willemsson. And by the way, if you have not subscribed to this podcast, you should definitely do it, because it's a great source of information from the team that makes Java. Let me just give you a few hints on what you can do. Reviewing the documentation may be very valuable. If you spot a mistake or something that is ambiguous, reporting it on the right mailing list will be extremely helpful. Spreading the word by publishing a blog post or talking at your local jug is also a great way to contribute to the OpenJDK. Testing early access versions, preview features, incubator or experimental features, and reporting bugs has a lot of value too. Reading the mailing list and participating by providing feedback or new ideas is also great. So if you feel like doing that, you can also read the bylaws of the OpenJDK that gives you details about how things are working. All the relevant pages and mailing lists are in the links down below. And with this, I'm out of news and almost out of coffee. So that's it for today. Talk to you soon.